Have you ever wondered how Americans react when they see the Hadzabe tribe's way of fighting? This might surprise you. In this video, we'll show you their unique fighting techniques and discuss their impact on the tribe and visitors. Firstly, why do people visit the Hadzabe tribe? The Hadzabe tribe is a group of people who live near Lake Eyasi in northern Tanzania. They have been living as hunter-gatherers for a very long time, maybe even 50,000 years. Their language used to be thought to be like the Khoisan language because of the click sounds they make, but now we know it's a unique language, not like any other. They are not closely related to any other tribe and live in a special place called the Great Rift Valley. What's really interesting is that, unlike most African tribes, their history doesn't say they came from somewhere else. This makes them one of the oldest tribes in Africa, if not the oldest. Because they're the oldest hunter-gatherers in Africa, people from America and vloggers from different countries are curious about how they survive. Many visitors visit Hadzabe land to learn about their daily life, culture, food, and more. They also want to watch the exciting sunrise hunt and see how these tough people have lived in the tough Tanzanian wilderness for thousands of years. Some vloggers even join the Hadzabe in hunting activities. Now let's understand, what's so great about their hunting practice that surprises Americans? The Hadzabe people have some very interesting ways of hunting animals. First, they watch the animals, like antelopes, for a long time, and then chase them over a big area. They are strong and can keep up with the animals. They use a bow and arrow to catch the animals, and the surprising thing here is they make their own bows and arrows from things they find around, like wood and animal sinew. To make it easier to catch animals, they sometimes put poison from the desert rose plant on their arrows. During their hunting trips, they have hunted different animals like baboons, antelopes, and buffalo, using these handmade poisoned bows and arrows. They also like to set traps. They use things like sticks and vines from the environment to make traps. These traps are good for catching small animals like birds and rats. So they have different methods to get their food, which is pretty cool. Also, the Hadzabe men don't just carry bows and arrows. They have many other things with them too. They have axes, poisoned and non-poisoned arrows, knives, little pots for honey, tools to make fire, shoes, clothes, and many other small things they need. When Americans or other people see the Hadza people hunting, they are amazed. The Hadza are good at hunting. They do it skillfully and precisely. At first, some people might be scared because it's different from what they're used to, but in the end, they are surprised at how the Hadza can catch their prey. The handmade bows and arrows of the Hadza also surprised Americans. They are made with a lot of attention to detail. Americans find it new and interesting to see these weapons' strength and power. The fact that they use poison on their arrows to hunt is also something that surprises them because it's a different way of hunting animals. Now let's talk about how Hadzabe couples live. It's not just the men who hunt. The women also gather food. They bring back fruits, berries, baobab fruit, and honey to their homes. We know that the Hadzabe tribe depends on hunting animals for food, which they cook and eat. But their diet isn't just meat. They also love honey, and it's a big part of their food. And when it comes to getting honey, it's a whole different story for men and women in the Hadza tribe. It might sound surprising, but the truth is the Hadza people have a unique relationship with a wild bird called the Greater Honey Guide. This relationship is all about helping each other out, but a bit of manipulation is involved. That bird helps the Hadza people find wild bees. When they get to the bees, they make noises like whistling, hitting trees, and even shouting to get the bird's attention. The bird also makes unique sounds to get the honey hunter's attention. Once the honey hunter knows where the bee nest is, he uses smoke to calm the bees and an axe to open the nest. He takes most of the honey, and the bird eats the beeswax left on the tree or ground. Sometimes, instead of giving food to the bird, the Hadza men hide or get rid of the wax to keep the bird hungry. This way, the bird will more likely help them find honey again. This way of collecting honey is very different and surprising to Americans. They think it's cool and love watching the Hadza people do it. Many vloggers who visit the Hadza tribe join them in hunting baboons or collecting honey because it's an exciting adventure. The Hadza's ability to communicate with animals and birds is amazing and unique. It's a special skill that sets them apart. Besides all these, Americans are deeply fascinated with exploring diverse cultures and lifestyles, which is why many vloggers who visit the Hadzabe tribe immerse themselves in the unique hunter-gatherer way of life. They join the Hadza people in their hunting expeditions, wake up early to share meals typical of the hunter-gatherer diet, and eagerly embrace the chance to learn about a completely different lifestyle. This includes understanding traditional hunting and gathering methods, picking up the Hadza language, and observing their customs. These experiences often profoundly impact them, opening their eyes to new perspectives and transforming their outlook. Additionally, this cultural exchange is a two-way street. Vloggers and documentarians engage in meaningful interactions with the Hadza, participating in traditional activities, sharing stories, and forming genuine friendships. This further builds mutual respect and understanding between the visitors and the tribe members, promoting unity and appreciation for each other's cultures. That's not it. Americans, vloggers, and documentarians visiting the Hadza tribe also take the opportunity to document and understand the challenges and difficulties the Hadza people have faced in recent times. Over the years, the Hadza's traditional territory has faced increasing encroachment from neighboring communities. To the west, Hadza lands have been turned into a private hunting reserve, and the Hadza is officially confined to a reservation within this reserve, where hunting is prohibited. This restriction severely limits their ability to access traditional hunting grounds. Moreover, the Yaeda Valley, which was previously uninhabited due to the presence of tsetse flies, is now occupied by Datuga herders. These herders have been clearing the Hadza lands on both sides of the valley to create pasture for their goats and cattle. Unfortunately, this land clearing has significant negative consequences for the Hadza. It not only drives away game animals that the Hadza rely on for food, but also destroys the berries, tubers, and honey that form a vital part of their diet. Additionally, the watering holes essential for the Hadza and their cattle are drying up due to the increased cattle herding by the Datuga. As a result, many Hadza people can no longer sustain themselves traditionally and require supplementary food like ugali to survive. While documentaries about the Hadza have brought attention to their unique way of life, the impact of tourism is not entirely positive. Much of the money generated from tourism does not directly benefit the Hadza people, but is instead allocated by government offices and tourism companies. This lack of direct financial support has led to alcoholism among the Hadza, with alcohol-related deaths becoming a serious problem, further eroding their cultural knowledge. In a particularly disheartening development in 2007, the local government controlling Hadza lands adjacent to the Yaeda Valley leased 6,500 square kilometers of land to the Al Nahyan royal family of the United Arab Emirates for their personal safari playground. The Hadza and Datuga were evicted from their ancestral lands, and some Hadza who resisted the eviction were imprisoned. However, due to protests by Hadza and negative coverage in the international media, the deal was eventually canceled. The Hadza people face additional challenges, including limited access to healthcare and changing social dynamics. However, what's remarkable is Hadza's ability to adapt and show resilience in these difficulties, which can inspire and provoke deep thoughts. These daily challenges faced by the Hadza concern Americans who become aware of their struggles. After spending time with the Hadza, some vloggers and documentarians feel a strong sense of social responsibility. They recognize these challenges and use their platforms to create awareness about issues like land rights, access to education, and healthcare for the Hadza community. Their efforts can increase support for humanitarian initiatives to improve Hadza's living conditions. Moreover, immersing themselves in Hadza culture often makes Americans, vloggers, and documentarians more culturally sensitive. They gain insights into the importance of preserving indigenous cultures and respecting their rights. This newfound awareness can significantly influence their future work and interactions, potentially leading to more meaningful advocacy for indigenous communities worldwide. So, what do you think of the Hadzabe tribe and Americans' reaction towards it? Comment below and subscribe for more.